So I have to admit something. I like watching videos of people failing. And I don't mean like failing at life, failing in a proposal, or finding out that they failed an exam. I'm talking about the guy who tries a skateboard trick and fails. The girl who tries a front handspring and fails. Like the duo who tries a dance routine and they hit heads. The cat who jumps at a bird outside and smacks into the window. I'm talking about those kind of fails. Like, do you love, like me, do you love watching these epic fails? Now, listen, I don't want to see anyone get seriously injured, but I'll admit, seeing other people fail, that's like super entertaining. I saw a fail clip on TikTok the other night where a girl does an incredible move with a soccer ball against the wall. Then it cuts to her trying to convince her friend to try the same move. And like, he seems reluctant, he knows it's not a good idea, and that he actually doesn't have the skill to pull it off. But then he tries it. He does his best imitation of her movement. He kicks the ball with all his strength. It hits the wall, then comes flying back and hits him in the back of the head. I was completely entertained, okay? It was funny because it seemed pretty clear that this guy knew he couldn't pull off the trick. But either the girl convinced him or he was just trying to impress her. Either way, he failed. And it was caught on camera for me to laugh at, right? It seems to me that so many of these fail videos happen because someone with a phone in their hand influences someone else to try something out of their skill set or something just downright foolish. And listen, not all of these things are caught on video for the world to see. Like, this stuff happens in just real life too. Like, maybe it happens to you, it's more like a friend talks you into wearing a ridiculous outfit. Maybe your friends talk you into asking a girl who is way out of your league for her number. Or your teammates are trying to pull off a prank and they talk you into joining them. It's just crazy how powerful of an effect we can have on each other. But this is also true in other areas of life, all right? Not just when we're doing something silly. We affect each other in all kinds of ways. See, sometimes the effect is negative. Like most of you have heard since you were young to be careful not to give in to peer pressure, right? You heard that all growing up probably. In other words, don't let other people influence you towards bad behavior like drinking or partying, lying or being disrespectful to authority figures. Sometimes we hear about the effect being positive. Most of us can identify a positive trait or characteristic in our own lives and connect it directly to someone else, maybe a parent or a small group leader, a coach or a teammate, and say, man, their influence on my life produced this character trait in me. Sometimes the effect that people can have on other people, sometimes it's just huge. Like maybe you've seen or heard stories of social media influencers who gain popularity by doing crazy stunts or starting a movement or showing off their talent. And all of a sudden, they have thousands upon thousands of followers. And whether their effect on all of those thousands of followers is positive or negative, one thing is certain, it is far-reaching. They are influencing a lot of people. What's interesting is that so many famous quotes can make you and I feel like our impact on the world, like it has to be humongous. And if it's not, it doesn't really make a difference at all. Quotes like this, the ones who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones that do. That's a quote by Steve Jobs. Or this quote, somewhere inside all of us is the power to change the world. Or this quote, we can change the world and make it a better place. It is in your hands to make a difference. Nelson Mandela. Nothing wrong with these quotes. They're super inspirational. But sometimes we feel like if we're going to have an effect on others, it has to be big and it has to be world-changing. And this has the potential to leave us overwhelmed and sometimes just discouraged because we think, like, who am I to change the world? Or we think that we have to change the world in order for our lives to matter. Like anything less than a massive movement of change would be a total disappointment. In other words, you start thinking the you effect has to be big in order to be legitimate. Which brings us to the passage we're gonna look at today. This account is about people who had an effect that was so big that it did in fact change the world. But what you and I can learn from what happened can be a game changer when it comes to the way we view our effect on others. Because these were a group of people everyone else had counted out. They banded together and little by little, their commitment to do small things led to a big movement. And that is the start of the early church. And there's a book in the New Testament of the Bible called Acts. And believe it or not, each of us have been affected by the events that were recorded in that book. Acts recorded the actions, get it? Acts for actions, that the first followers of Jesus took. It's an account of the early church. It described the impact of the few early followers of Jesus as they traveled and talked about and lived for Jesus throughout the Roman Empire. And there's a powerful moment that happened when these early followers of Jesus were gathered together. It's called Pentecost. The Spirit of God showed up in what was described as a violent wind. And the people began worshiping God in a big way. And the people who witnessed this were confused. They were like, okay, like what in the world is going on here? In fact, some of them thought that the followers of Jesus were actually drunk. And Peter, one of Jesus' disciples, stood up and explained, hey y'all, we're not drunk at all. And he took the opportunity to talk about Jesus in that moment. And after Peter preached a powerful message about who Jesus was and what Jesus was about, look at what happened next. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. So this sermon from Peter, the same Peter who had started out as a fisherman, who had denied that he knew Jesus in Jesus' time of need, that same Peter preached, and it was a massive effect on the people around him. A lot of people were impacted and in a great direction. And this is the kind of influence we all love to have on the world, right? This is what we think about when we talk about influence, something that will change the masses, will change thousands of people. But what's interesting is what happens next. These new followers of Jesus didn't walk away, tell Peter, hey man, great sermon, then go back to minding their own business. Listen to this. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. And these were the people that made up the early church. In fact, they didn't even use the word church back then. They were known instead as a gathering of people with a shared cause. They didn't know that a couple thousand years later, we'd be sitting here reading about them, talking about them, learning from them. They weren't seeking to start a big movement, get a bunch of Instagram followers, and become known as influencers. They were simply people whose lives had been transformed by the life-changing truth of Jesus. See, something big happened in their lives that changed them and influenced them and caused them to live their lives differently than they had before. So, what did they do that was so different? What was so big that it led them to change the world and lead them to become credited as the people who started the church as we know it today? Well, it was actually quite simple. They focused on doing the next right thing and loving one another. The things they did were behaviors, but they were based in their character and the shared mission that they believed in. They were changed people who had been transformed by the big love of Jesus. And because of that, something big happened in their lives that influenced each of them. But it was the small steps they took that gave them influence. These people started a movement that has influenced millions for over 2,000 years. But it started simply by them caring about the people around them. They devoted themselves to helping each other. They gave to people in need. They worshiped God together and prayed for each other. They were focused on the people, not the movement they were building, not the organization they were growing, not the followers they were hoping to impress. They simply loved, served, and cared about the community they were in. That was their character. They had no idea the big effect their lives would have in the long run. And see, in the moment, we rarely see the effect that our lives can have on the people around us. See, the early church was built on love, and their first step was to care about people nearest to them, doing what they could, where they were. And the impact of that love is still having an effect on us today. And think of it this way. Having a big effect starts with a small step. Having a big effect starts with just a small step. Now, sure, the violent wind and the sermon from Peter kickstarted the whole thing, right? But the reason why the Lord added to their number daily was because of small sacrificial acts of love, kindness, and compassion. This is what the early church was built on, and this is why it grew and sustained despite a lot of opposition. Like, just think about, can you imagine some of the fears these people may have dealt with? Like, if I sell my stuff to help others, what if I don't have enough for myself? What if people don't notice, appreciate, or care about my sacrifice? What if I do all these little steps and it doesn't seem to make a difference in anybody else's life? But they didn't think that way. Or if they did, they didn't let it stop them from doing what they knew they needed to do. It's astonishing how selfless this group of people were. Despite the fear they may have had, the natural fear that we would all have, how did they do it? Well, they were motivated by the love of Jesus. As they realized just how big the love of Jesus was for each of them personally, they were content to take the next small step of extending that love towards each other. In other words, as they understood the heart of Jesus towards the people around them, they developed a bigger heart for the people around them. See, having a big effect starts with a small step. It starts with love. But how do we get started? Well, I think that we ought to just start the same place the early church did, with what's around us. Like, start by looking around. See the people. See the relationships. See the community God has placed in your life. Like, what are the needs that you see? Recognize that having an effect starts here. You and I cannot affect other people if we don't see them. So we need to think small. Does your little brother need someone to teach him how to play baseball or basketball or whatever sport you may know how to play? Do you have a friend that struggles in a particular class that you could help him or her in? Could you offer to babysit your siblings and maybe even do the laundry for your mom? Is there a local little league or boys and girls club or after school program where you could volunteer? Just, hey, start small. And second is, be honest with yourself. Like, what is holding you back from taking a step and meeting needs around you? Is it fear? Are you disinterested? Is it feeling like you want to do something so much bigger than that, something that matters more than the world right in front of you? See if you can put words around what's holding you back. And then third is, take a step. Just take a step, a small step to meet a need that you see. Don't let the idea of, oh, this step is too small or too insignificant. Don't let that keep you from doing what only you can do. The you effect is about caring for others, whoever they are, wherever they are. So start where you are. Don't make it complicated. Just get moving, a small step. Whether we feel like it or not, we all affect the people and the world around us. We have the potential to affect outcomes and situations around us every day. So when you wake up in the morning and you see your mom or brother for the first time, you have the ability to impact the way their day will start, which in turn could affect their entire day. You have the ability to encourage your best friend when he or she is having a bad day. You affect people on a daily basis, and your effect is more significant than you think. So do not count yourself out. It all starts with love. All of it starts with love, which is both the biggest and the smallest step of them all.